We're in the first page of Kapach's introduction to Mishneh Torah. We'll continue where we left off yesterday. Shakanu rov itot limudenu b'havayot da'abaye v'rava. We spent most of our time, meaning he's recollecting what he studied with his father and grandfather in Yemen. We spent most of our time studying the writings of Abaye and Rava. What's that? The Gemara. Uchsevat Rabbeinu. And whenever he says Rabbeinu, he means? The Rambam. Like Rabbeinu, the Rambam told us, Besof Perek Dalid Yisudei Torah, in the end of the fourth chapter of the laws of Yisudei Torah, which is in this book. V'ani Omer, and I say, it's interesting, whenever the Rambam uses these words, Ani Omer, Yireli, it seems that he's introducing opinion, and the question is, what do you do with the Rambam when he introduces opinion? There's a Chacham from Chachmei Ashkenaz, he wrote a whole book on every place where the Rambam wrote Yireli, it appears to me. What does it mean? V'ani Omer, and I say, Shein ra'ui letayel b'pardes, that it's improper for a person to travel into the Pardes, whatever you want to understand the Rambam referring to when he means that. We'll do that when we get to that chapter. Elamish nitmale kereso lechem ubasar. A person who's keres, what's a keres? It's a part of your body, that's karet. What's a keres? Your
head.
Keres is a belly. Oh, a beten is it's the technical. A keres is like when you get a little bit of a, not like anybody here would know what I'm talking about. But a person should not go to the pardes until his keres is full of lechem ubasar, of bread and meat. What does that mean? Velechem ubasar hu leida ha'asur v'amutar v'chayotze mehem mishar ha'mitzvot. And this means that you have, what is bread and meat in the context of Torah? To know what is forbidden and what is permitted. With everything that is forbidden and permitted and all the halachot of the Torah. Vafalpi shedvarim elu davar katan kiru otan hachachamim. And even though our chachamim call this a small thing, it's not a very big area of learning. Sharamu chachamim davar gadol ma'aseh merkava v'davar katan havayot da'beh v'rava. Our rabbis tell us what's the big area of study? Ma'aseh merkava. The matter of the chariot. You know, there's ma'aseh bereshit and ma'aseh merkava. And these things are a foundation for much of what you want to call the deeper parts of the Torah. V'davar katan, in the small area of study, is havayot da'abaye v'rava. Talmud. And even though that's true, you should study them first, even though they're not so important. The study of halacha is not so important. But you should study it first. Why? Because they calm down a person's mind. The correct translation we'll get to when we do this perek. It's the practical things you need to know in order to inherit this world, in order to live your life correctly as a Jewish person. And therefore, it's the area of study which we must do first. Maran writes a Shulchan Aruch. In how many segments? 30. Yes, that's Maran writes. So, want to bring me the old Shulchan Aruch. Where's that old Shulchan Aruch here? The brown set. You want to look for the one that says Orach Chaim Aleph.
Oh, yes.
Yeah. But it's okay. We have you have it here too. Look
okay.
Yeah. Maran writes as an introduction to Shulchan Aruch. Riti ani bilibi. Maran says, I saw it in my heart, ki tov lilkot shoshanei sapiri im rav. Sapirei imarav b'derech tzara b'shontzach v'kolel yafe v'naim leman tiyeh Torah Hashem t'mima shgura b'fi kodesh Yisrael. I wanted to collect all the writings of my Bet Yosef into a book that would be easy to read, so every person could know it by heart. כי כאשר ישענו לתמי חכם דבר הלכה, when a person will ask a תמי חכם a question הלכה, לא יגמגם בה. He shouldn't stutter and not know the הלכה. אלא יאמר לחוכמה אחותי את. He should say to the wisdom, you are my sister. As the rabbi say, כשם שברור לו שאחותו אסורה לו, כך יהיה ברור לו כל דין שישן עליו הלכה למעשה. ביותו, a person, just like a person knows that he can't marry his sister, that's how you know that halakha. You know there's no argument about that halakha. You know there's no other opinion about that halakha. That's how you should know every halakha. Should know every halakha so well as you know the halakha that you can't marry your sister. Biyoto shagu b'fiv sefer zeh banu l'talpiyot. It says you should know this book by heart. Shulchan Aruch. Shakol ponim bo. That everyone looks inside. L'chalkol ha'chalakim 30 l'ilmod bo kol yom chelek. I've broken up the book into 30 parts, so you can learn one part every day. And at the end of every month, you'll finish the whole Shulchan Aruch. And I'll say to him, how praiseworthy is it that a person can come here, meaning come to the next world with his Torah under his hands? You know your Torah well. So who do you read this book for? This is meant for the Talmidei Chachamim who study the Beit Yosef and know all the opinions. It's a way for them to remember the halachot well, so you can know them every day. Who else did he write Shulchan Aruch for? Zot ve'od ha-talmidim ha-ktanim, the little children, the small children. Yehgu bo-tamid, they'll learn this book always. V'yishananu l'shono al-peh, and they'll memorize the wording by heart. V'yitiyah gersad yankut ha-mesudert b'fiyah mikatnutam, halakha l'maaseh. And that way, the things they learn as a child, they'll memorize Shulchan Aruch by heart. And they know it by heart. וגם כי יסכינו לסור ממנה. And when they get older, they won't forget it. Maran is of the opinion that his Shulchan Aruch is supposed to be finished every month. You finish Shulchan Aruch every month. How long is it going to take you before you memorize Shulchan Aruch? A year? 2 years? How long does it take you to memorize Shulchan Aruch? It's not a long book. It's only 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14 volumes, 15 volumes. Yeah, every month. For the little kids. That's the... What's not realistic? Maran intended, he wrote the Shulchan Aruch for that to happen. Look at the page of Shulchan Aruch. Look. See a page of Shulchan Aruch? That's Maran. Yeah? That's not Maran. That's not even Maran. That's the Rama already. So, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 lines on this page are Maran. You don't think it's easy to just memorize everything Maran says? You could finish the whole Shulchan Aruch. You want to start arguing about opinions, do that in your own time. But you don't want to study all 4 volumes of Shulchan Aruch. It's the first 2. You don't want to do the first 2. HaChaim, the first one. Why don't you just take 1 volume of Shulchan Aruch? That should take you all of 7 days. That's the laws of prayer, the laws of waking up in the morning, the laws of Shabbat, the laws of the holidays, the laws of Pesach, Purim, Shavuot, Sukkot, Chanukah, Rosh Chodesh. A good 100 chapters on Shabbat. You could do that all in the week. Next week, Tuesday night, you'll know Shulchan Aruch. It's possible. That's right, with all the commentaries. See, whenever someone writes a book to simplify halakha, someone else writes a book to complicate it. The Chachamim decide, Rabbi Yehuda HaNasih decides to write a Mishnah. And then what do? It's too complicated to write a Mishnah. We write a Gemara. What did the Gemara do? It took 6 books on the Mishnah and turned it into dozens and dozens of books. Now, the Gemara wasn't enough. I just started writing commentaries to the Gemara. If that was enough, so the Rif comes along. Rabbi Yitzchak Alfasi comes and makes an abridged version of the Gemara. Abridged. Just the halachot. Take out all the stories. Take out all the arguments. Just an abridged version of the Gemara. What do? We write commentaries on his book also. So along comes the Rambam. And the Rambam says, guys, forget it, last chance. We're going to write a book of halachot so that you will only need two books in your library. The Tanakh and the Mishneh Torah. That's it. Everybody will know halacha. What do we do? Start writing commentaries in the Rambam. So along comes the tool. This is God. Last chance. We're going to write a tool, Shulchan Aruch. Everything you need is not even going to include like the Rambam, all the fancy stuff, the extra stuff. We're just going to talk about the halachot that are relevant outside of the land of Israel. And along come the Jews and write a commentary on it. So then Maran says, this is ridiculous. Even he wrote a commentary on the tool. He also wrote a commentary on the Rambam. So Maran says, last chance. We're going to make a Shulchan Aruch so even little children can read Shulchan Aruch and memorize it by heart. And along come all the other rabbis and write commentaries on it. So whenever we try to make it simple, someone makes it complicated. And halakha has reached this place where unless you know 1,000 opinions about something, you don't even know halakha. My favorite question, well, that's what Maran says. So what about, I don't know, you break my head now. What about everybody else? You want to follow everybody else? Go follow everybody else. I know Maran said it was okay. You want to have a problem with it? Go somewhere. How much do you want us to... How much do you study before it becomes Bitul Torah? I'm saying now something brazen. How much Torah do you study before the time you waste studying things that are not important become a waste of time studying Torah? What, every Torah you study, it's now okay to study whatever you want. You want to do study of Gemara. You want to learn Gemara every day. Good. So now you fulfill the mitzvah of studying Torah. Studying Gemara. Okay, so Maran writes here. He's just quoting a Rambam and then a Gemara. We did this once together on Shavuot. Maran writes, Chayav Adam Neshalesh Limudon. A person who must make their learning into three parts. Shlish batorah, a third has to be Torah, shebichtav, written Torah. Dahinu arba v'esrim, the 24 books of the Tanakh. Shlish b'mishnah, a third of Mishnah, dahinu Torah shebal peh, upirush Torah shebichtav, b'chal zeh. So that includes the Mishnah and the Talmud. And then it says shlish b'talmud, a third has to be Talmud. If the second is Talmud, so what's the third category? When Chachamim use the word Talmud, they really mean what we call Halacha. Yes, you should know this is a rule in your heads. What Chachamim call Talmud, we call Halacha. For them, Talmud was Halacha. Not Halacha like, do this, don't do that. The study of Torah Shebal Peh to reach you to the conclusions, analyzing the sources to reach Halacha. Then he says... Maran. Kitzad, how much time a day do you spend studying? Hayam baal umanut, if you are a person with a profession. Ve'osek b'mlachto gimel sha'ot b'yom v'tet b'torah. If you study 3 hours, you work 3 hours a day, and you study Torah 9 hours a day. That's a working person in the eyes of Maran. So if you are working more than 3 hours a day, according to Maran, you're probably in the category of a slave, not in the category of a working person. Yes? What? That's rough. Yes. Rambam also. Maran, yes. Therefore, Korea Gimel Mihem B'Torah Shebichtav, you spend 3 of those hours you study reading Torah. Gimel Torah Shebal Peh, a third, I mean 3 hours. And then the other 3 hours you study Halacham. באמת דברים אמורים, which, when is this said, which stage in your learning? בתחילת לימודו של אדם, in the beginning of when a person studies Torah. אבל כשיגדיל בתורה, when you grow up in Torah, and you know Torah well, ולא יצריך ללמוד תורה שבכתב, ולא לעסוק תמיד בתורה שבעל פה, when you no longer have any need to study Tanakh all the time, or Talmud all the time, because you know those books by heart. You grew up already. יקרא בעיתים מזומנים תורה שבכתב ודברי תורה שבעל פה כדי שלא ישכח דבר מדיני התורה. At that point, you should just review periodically your studies of the Tanakh and of the Talmud so you don't forget things. ויפנה כל ימיו לתלמוד בלבד, לפי רוחב ליבו וישוב דעתו. At that point in time, you should spend your time studying Talmud. What Talmud? Understanding Halakha in depth. Yes? And that's every person, depending on how much intellectual capacity they have, that's what they should spend the rest of their life studying. Says the Rama, Haga, note, V'yesh omrim, שבתלמוד בבלי, some say the Rama, some say that with the Babylonian Talmud, שהוא בלול במקרא, במשנה ובגמרא, אדם יוצא ידי חובתו בשביל הכל. The Rama is in a dilemma here. How do you justify that in Ashkenaz, the Jews really only study Gemara? This Talmud Bavli includes Mishnah, includes Torah, includes Halakha. Because of that, it's considered a study of that all. I want to read you the Shach. Shach, Siftei Kohen. Probably the most classic Ashkenazi commentary on Shulchan Aruch. Shach quotes the Drisha. We've quoted the Drisha before. Drisha, Prisha, he had a mother or a wife who was a big time in the Chama. He quotes her in the Halakha in the laws of lighting candles for Shabbat. Kadav Drisha, the Drisha writes, Yesh Baalei Batim, there are some working folk. Noagim Lilmod Bechol Yom Gapat. They study Gapat. What is Gapat? Gemara, Perush Rashi, and Tosafot. So they study Talmud. They don't study Talmud, a 15-minute a day Talmud class. They don't do 1 hour of Daf Yomi. They don't do. They do serious, intense Gemara with Rashi, with Tosafot. That's already intense learning of Gemara. Velo Shaar Poskim, but they don't study the writings of the Poskim. They study Talmud. Umevim Raya, Madam. אבל אני ראה, it appears to me, שיש ללמוד ספרי הפוסקים. You have to study the writings of the rabbis who dealt with הלכה. דיני התורה כמו עריף ומורדכי והראש ודמיהם. וזהו שורש וכל תורתנו, ואינם יוצאים כלל בלימוד גפת. It says that, and unless they study הלכה, they don't fulfill at all the mitzvah of learning Torah with the study of Talmud. And then he says, who is he talking about? We're talking about a person who has 9 hours a day to study Torah. The Kivan Sheshlo Pnai Gadol Yilmod Bashas. He has 9 hours. Of course he can study Gemara. Aval Hinech Baalei Batim. But the Baalei Batim that we have, the ones who don't have 9 hours a day to study, Shenam Lodim Ragima No Arbat Shod. They only study 3 or 4 hours a day. I mean, there's a 9-hour ideal person who's working, and there's the one who, what can they do? They only have 4 hours a day to study Torah. Yeah? What about those people? Lo yilmedu bashas lechud. They cannot study just Gemara. Why? The Shach is quoting this halakha. Somebody who studies Gemara, and that's all they study, if one takes 2 hours a day to study Gemara, well, they don't fulfill a mitzvah of studying Torah at all. So instead of wasting time, go study things you need to study. We should mention Tanakh. We mentioned Halakha. You want the Mishneh Torah. It's easier. It flows nicer. You want Shulchan Aruch. You can finish it in 30 days. Whatever you want. Those are books you have to own. It's important. What I'm saying now is not because something is called Torah, you can study it. Not everybody has enough hours in their day where they have the right to study whatever they want to. I didn't even talk here about people who go off and study all kinds of other things that I don't want to mention in front of the camera. They study Torah, the real Torah, the deep Torah. Secret Torah, the Torah that no one heard about before then. they spend talking about which ventricle in your heart has a Yetzer Hara inside of it and which one doesn't. They didn't even study yet Tanakh or Halacha. You ask them a simple question, how do you wash your hands in the morning? They don't know. Says Rabbi Yosef Kapach, I studied Torah the way my father and my grandfather taught us to study Torah, which was at 5 years old, we studied Tanakh. At 10 years old, we finished the Tanakh, we start Mishnah. At 15 years old, we finished the Mishnah, we studied the Talmud. And we spent most of our life studying Talmud lehalacha, meaning studying those texts to reach the halachic conclusions of those texts. ובמצוות רבנו לתלמידו רבי יוסף בר רבי יהודה חזקנו שכתב לו, he writes to his student, רבי יוסף, the son of רבי יהודה, in the letters of the Rambam, וכבר הזרתיך, and I already warned you, says the Rambam to his student, שלא תתרשל, you should not become lazy, עד שתדע את כל החיבור, until you know the entire משנה תורה by heart, ויהו ספרך, let it be your book, ותלמדהו בכל מקום, and teach it everywhere, כדי שתשיג את כל תועלתו, so you can maximize the benefit of the משנה תורה. ואין, we're on page Yud at the top, המטרה העיקרית אלה ידיעת מה שצריך לעשות. The whole purpose of studying Torah is to know what are you supposed to do. How do you do it? וממה להימנע, what you're not allowed to do. וזה ברור לאדם כמוך, it should be clear to a person like you, my student. ולפיכך נחלצנו בחיבור משנה תורה, למען המטרה העיקרית כדי להקל זכירתו. And therefore, says the Rambam, we wrote this book of the Mishneh Torah in order to make it easy to memorize. וכן ראוי לך שתלמד שיעור זה מלשון הקודש, אשר חיברנו בו את החיבור, and then I recommend that you study it in its original Hebrew, so you can know that's the language I wrote it in, says the Rambam. כי הוא קל להבנה, it's an easy Hebrew. And for those of you who are going to begin learning Mishneh Torah with me, you're going to realize the Hebrew of the Mishneh Torah is not complicated at all. That's the brilliance of the Mishneh Torah. It's not complicated. You don't sit there scratching your head, what does the Rambam mean? The Rambam, it's not serving on a silver platter. It's putting it into your mouth with a silver spoon. וכאן מאוד לדעת אותו. It's very easy to know the Mishneh Torah. גם יתר ספריו לא משכנו ידינו, רב קפח is now the one speaking. He says, and you should know from the rest of the Rambam's books, we also didn't stop studying, meaning we always studied his writings. כי כולם חטיבה אחת. The Rambam is all one, I don't know how to translate this one. One chativa b'anus. The Rambam is all one. Yes, maybe for the next sentence you understand what he means. Echad hu Rambam. The Rambam is only one Rambam. Hilchotav in his halachot, machshavotav, uvashkavotav in his thoughts, in his theology. V'divrei anshei asina v'akina v'atavot ishlachnu achar gavenu. And all the words of those haters and those jealous people and those, we rejected all of them. He's making a reference, not important for us now. The Rambam is one Rambam. I think it's very important to know this. There are many Jews over time. I have a video, old one, Baruch put up online, called Don't Study the Rambam, Follow the Rambam. People have a hard time with the Rambam. If I told you the other night, the Rabbi Yosef Kapach says that everyone looks at the Rambam like he's a mirror. They see themselves in the Rambam. They project themselves in the Rambam. There's also parts of the Rambam that people have a very hard time accepting. For some people, it's his halachot. For some people, it's his moed nevuchim. For some people, it's his philosophy. For some people, it's a lack of discussion. For some, everyone has something else that they didn't like in the Rambam. They were great chachamim. I mean, I'm not saying who banned the study of the Rambam's books entirely. It's a very mainstream thing in the Jewish world today to say you can study the halachot of the Rambam, but not the theology of the Rambam. It's a very mainstream thing. It's a normative thing to hear. Study the Rambam's Mishneh Torah, but don't touch his Moed Nevuchim. Don't touch his ideologies. But says Rav Kapach, we didn't reject any part of the Rambam. Someone who truly understands the Rambam knows he's one Rambam. All around he's a Rambam. And that's important to know. Achat hua Rambam. What is it? Echad hua Rambam. The Rambam is one. He's one. Don't get scared. You're going to hear from people, what are you studying Mishneh Torah for? Do you know we don't follow the Mishneh Torah? Do you know we don't follow the Rambam? What value is there in knowing the Rambam? It's just one opinion. It's wonderful to hear such things. But the Rambam, for some of us, is the main road. This is the highway. This is the Chacham that gave us everything. And how you reconcile what the Rambam didn't give us, that's already a different conversation that I don't think I'll have here. At least not in this shiur. But what he did give us, we're very excited about. B'ezras Hashem, next shiur we have, Rav Kapach is going to discuss all about the handwritten manuscripts that his family had from the Rambam, how they got them, how did those manuscripts even begin to be written, why are there handwritten manuscripts of the Rambam, why is there no authoritative printing of the Rambam's Mishneh Torah. You know, we have a Shulchan Aruch, the edition that was printed in Maran's lifetime, and we can trace changes that happened since then. Yes? I spoke here once about Kaparot, and how in Maran, the Rambam printed, the first Shulchan Aruch printed, it says in the title, Maran calls, you want to say the editor, in the first edition of Shulchan Aruch, it says, Kaparot minhag shtutu. It's a stupid custom, a silly custom, nonsensical custom. In all the editions of Shulchan Aruch you have today, it doesn't say that sentence. Editing. How do we know? Because the first one had it. It's not like the second one had it, so the first one didn't and the third one didn't. The first one had and the second one didn't. Why is it that we don't have authoritative scripts or texts of the Rambam's printing? Yosef Kapach is going to answer that, B'zat Hashem, next week. It has to do with the way the Rambam published his Mishneh Torah and what was happening in the Rambam's. You know, this is not the kind of book you write in one night. It's not the kind of book you publish in one day. Not everyone buys a 14-volume set of books. You write a chapter, you send it here. You write a chapter, you send it there. And that leads to variations or variant scripts in the Rambam, which Yosef Kapach mentioned yesterday already. He mentioned to us that sometimes you see the Rambam writes one thing, then a second book he changes an opinion, then the third time he changes the opinion, the fourth time even he changes the opinion. So which opinion do you follow? That becomes part of the work of studying the writings of the Rambam. Before I end, when I mentioned earlier about the quote from a certain Talmid Chacham, this Talmid Chacham is a dear friend of mine. I don't mean anything as a jab on a personal level, but I'm showing that in the mainstream Jewish world, that's an approach that many people have. The approach is the Rambam and Halachot is the greatest of all. But the Rambam has an ideology that is so strange, that is so bizarre, that is so unpalatable to the Jewish palate who's used to a different kind of Torah. It shouldn't surprise you when we begin to study the opposition towards the Rambam and certain writings of his. Whether that narrative is true or not is not for me to discuss at this moment in time. But it's important to know that even Talmid Chachamim, like I mentioned, those that I respect, even they sometimes have this approach. And you should know about it because when it comes time to confront it, you want to know that it's there.